Today's class is the final class. I've just prepared a few topics mainly around time series based data analysis because that was one request from a few people here was that their projects in the AMH program is related to these time based data systems. So I thought I would just talk a bit about those topics, but then the things I'm talking about also apply, of course, to other non-time based systems. So if you're analyzing data, say, from just a whole collection of observations, not necessarily ordered in time, then these rules and concepts we're talking about will also be applicable. But they mainly come from time-based systems also. I just also wanted to mention that there's a whole bunch of publications related to multivariate data analysis on the MACC website. So if you go look at the publications subsection on MACC.mcmaster.ca, it's all of John McGregor's group's papers have been hyperlinked there. If you're on an on-campus computer, you can download the PDFs because all the links just go to the journal websites, and because you're on campus, you can use the journal publications. So if there's some topic there that we haven't covered in the class, there's a lot of topics we haven't covered in the class, but things like multivariate characterization and multivariate specification limits, model inversion for design of new products, all of those topics are, I really wish actually I had another two classes to go through some of those interesting things because I think they will maybe spark some ideas for your research areas that you're involved in. But nevertheless, I think you're now at a good point after these four classes that you can go read those papers. So the notation I've used in my course notes is the same as used in those papers. So you should be very comfortable reading some of those things if you see any interesting topics. And also, if you ever come across something you don't quite understand, you can just email me. Okay, so today I'm just going to introduce the coefficient plot in PLS. We did speak about it a bit last time, but I'll just go through it a little bit more formally. So the coefficient plot is great when you've got more than a handful of components. So once you get to about four or so principal components in a PLS model, you've got to go look at W star C 1, 2, 3, and 4, and some higher numbers. So that gets a little bit hard to look at when, if you're really just interested in how the X's are related to the Y. If you're interested in how the X's relate to each other and how the Y's relate to each other, you have to go through the W star C 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on plots. But if you're only interested in how the X's are related to the Y, in other words, you're more interested in PLS now, not as a projection setup. I mean, PLS has got these two names, so let me just quickly go on a sidetrack. But PLS has got these two names, projection to latent structures and partial least squares. And the two names are kind of indicative of the way people use them. Projection to latent structures indicates you're projecting your data to a lower latent structure. So that's more when you're interested in how the X's are related to each other, how the Y's are related to each other, and also how the X's are related to the Y's, because you're projecting your X and Y data to this latent structure. But if you're interested in PLS more as a regression tool, then you're interested in how the X's are related only to the Y's, then maybe the coefficient plot will be more applicable to what you're looking for in the moment. So the derivation last week was pretty straightforward. We said, bring in your X nu and you multiply it by W star C. So T nu is equal to X nu transpose times W star. So this is projecting your new vector of X's onto these loading directions given by W star. So you get your new scores. Now you take those scores, multiply by C transpose to get your Y predicted. If you substitute these two equations into each other, you will get X nu transpose W star C is Y nu. So in other words, you're relating X nu directly to Y nu. You're doing exactly what a multiple linear regression model will do. And in fact, we use the same terminology. We say X nu times this set of regression coefficients, beta, gives you y nu. So in this case, beta is a k by n matrix. So So you'll have as many columns K as you've got columns in X. And you'll have maybe 1, 2, 3 columns if you've got 3 Y predictors, 3 Y hats. So N is your number of Ys. So you'll get a vector of regression coefficients relating KX variables to the first Y. Another set of regression coefficients that relate the second y to the x's, and then a third one if you've got 3 y predictors. So you can go and inspect each one of these columns as a bar plot. So for multiple linear regression, you would have got the same thing. You would have got y hat is equal to x mu times beta, except when we're dealing with multiple linear regression, beta is usually a single column vector. In this instance, beta is a matrix because we've got a prediction for every single y in our model. Okay, so this shows here that how we get go directly from the x's to the y's. Now, I just put a note here that I don't recommend you do this in practice. I don't go use the PLS model this way. Only use the matrix to go learn from your model, to understand what's going on here in which x's are related to which y. So use it to link your x space to your y space just for learning purposes. But if you're going to implement PLS in software, don't do it this way. Why not? What are we missing by going directly from x to y? Yeah, so you're missing the t-scores, and from your t-scores you calculate Quetelling's t-squared and you calculate SPE. So those, by going directly from x to y, you're doing exactly what multiple linear regression is doing. You're going from x to y using your beta vector. Remember in PLS we don't have that. We actually have a two-step. We use our W stars to go from x to the t's. And then we can take those t's and predict y nu using c. Okay, so we calculate our t's by going to the c's, and then we get to our y hat. So in PLS, don't bypass this when you implement the system, because those t's are very valuable to calculate Hotelling's t squared, and you can also calculate the SPE. The SPE you get by saying x hat is equal to t nu, and then so that's x hat nu, and then you can calculate, sorry, the errors is x minus x hat. That's all in the notes, don't worry about that. But the point is, don't try to skip those two steps when you're implementing PLS. Okay, so here's a model. What I did here was I've just calculated the coefficient plot for this LDP case study we looked at last week. So let me just go for a second, go back to the software. You don't need to do this with me, but I'll just show it to you. You'll remember the LDP case study from last week. This is the W star C plot, and I've shown black those X variables and in red 5 Y variables. So you'll remember the study where we were predicting the 5 quality variables based on these 19 X variables, the process data. Remember, we saw things last week that the conversion is related to the temperature and flow rate. It's negatively correlated to Z2, and so on. But this is W star C1 and 2. There's also W star C3, 4, 5, and I think there may be even a 6th component here. So if you want to understand how these X's are related to these Y's, you have to go through components 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Or you can just bring up the coefficient plot, which summarizes, 7 components, summarizes the relationship from those x's to that y variable over all 7 components. So now you don't have to go look at each one of the W stars. You can now take a look here and see that temperature T max 2 over here is positively related to the y, and then Cn negatively correlated to the y, and then there's a few. Obviously, these variables in the center here are not important in order to predict y. So those x's just for that one Y variable are not important. It doesn't mean that they're unimportant overall, because we've got four other Ys in this model. So these X's over here in the center region, they may be important for other Ys, but for this particular Y conversion, they're not that important. So now we can then just, and we're learning here that which variables are related to that Y. What we should see as well is that least for the first two components, it often agrees with the W star C plot. So I've highlighted here the variables that are positively correlated with conversion. And you should see that reflected for the most part, in the W star C plot. So here's conversion over here. And those selected X's are indeed positively correlated with that Y. And similarly, if I go select the negative X's, you should see those on the other side of the W star C plot. Okay, well, it's interesting, yeah. So Tn is over here, but Z2 and Tcn2 are negatively correlated with conversion. This is showing Tn up here as a negative relationship to coefficient. Let's go take a look at that one. That's a little bit interesting. So Tn is actually the most negatively related to conversion. And that's probably because of the second component over here. So they're oppositely related in the second component. And maybe they're also oppositely correlated in the third and fourth component. So that's why the coefficient plot is quite nice, because it's summarizing for you here over all seven components what the relationships are between these x's and that one y. So it saves you from having to go look at all the W star c's, but it should also agree with the W star c's, at least for the first few. It should be pretty much strongly related. Okay, any questions on the coefficients? Just a question here for you to think about. What do you see the coefficient plots helping you with in a PLSTA model? So a PLSTA model, remember we said last week, is exactly like a PLS model, except your Y variable is now a 0 or a 1. Remember those? So given that it's an ordinary PLS model, we can also generate a coefficient plot for PLSTA. What do you think the coefficient plot would be telling you in a PLSTA model? What I'm more after is what sort of information? What would you interpret from a coefficient plot on a PLSTA model? Would you interpret it the same way? You definitely would interpret it the same way. But so, given that it's a PLSTA model, what would the coefficients be telling you then? What would a large positive coefficient tell you? No, I mean a large positive coefficient over here in the coefficient plot. So we're now looking at, let's just illustrate it on the board. We're now saying y mu is equal to x mu. So these are our variables that we're going to use to try and make that class-based discrimination times beta. And let's just make it easy that we've got the single y vector. So our y vector is going to look like, going to have zeros for the rows that are in the first class, and it's going to have ones for the observations in the second class. So I'm asking, if you plot the beta vector now, so remember this is going to be a vector that's k by 1 vector, what would it tell you? So we're going to have a regression coefficient for every x. What would you interpret, for example, a large beta value in that vector to be, or to mean?
Large coefficient.
With?
Between y and x.
Right, and how would you interpret it? So say, for example, this x would be the density of something. And so you're measuring various properties of your samples, and the large beta corresponds to a density value.
A linear deviation.
Okay, and remember our objective is here is to separate between two classes, class A and class B. of the one. So that would be telling you that density is an important variable to distinguish between the two classes. It's a variable that's strongly different between class A and class B. Okay? Whereas a variable in beta, so we said beta for the density was, say, a large positive. What if we had another raw material property, say, called the viscosity, mu, which in chemical engineering we'll denote viscosity by mu, and that beta is approximately zero. So it tells you...
insignificant.
Yeah, it's not important to telling the difference between class A and B. And then similarly, if you had beta for some other property, say number average molecular weight was a large negative, it would then say, it would be important as well for distinguishing the two classes. It's just related to the to one of the other two. Instead of being, this would be related to class B, this would be related to class A. But it's still, either way, a large positive or a large negative in a coefficient plot from a PLSDA model is extremely informative. It's showing you which variables are separating the two classes. Whereas variables which have small coefficients like these here in the center, approximately zero, those variables are not that important in telling your two classes apart. And in fact, you could maybe eliminate them from your model if they're expensive to measure. It's showing you that these variables are not really contributing to the ability to tell the two classes apart. So variables with small beta, or these here in the center, in other words, when you've sorted them like that, those variables can be eliminated. At least they can be eliminated for the purpose of telling A and B apart. If you've got a third class in here, maybe A and C, they might be, those variables might be important to tell some of your other classes apart, but at least for the A and B separation, they're not that important. So coefficients are a nice way to summarize your PLS model when you're interested in the relationship between the X space and the Y space. Okay. Now, let's take a look at some other topics. Today's class, as I said earlier on, for those of you that came late, is just a collection of a few topics that I really want to make sure you, that you guys are familiar with, because from things I've heard from you, they're what you're using in your MEng program and for your projects. So here's one of these other topics that I think will be useful for you. If you're looking at designed experiments, in the undergraduate part of the class, we looked at the case where we only have our factors X, and we built a least squares model to predict the single Y. So we were looking at designed experiments, and say you had A, B, and C as your three factors. You created a matrix, so minus one, plus one, minus one, plus one. And then for B's go minus, minus, plus, plus. And C's. And then you could expand that matrix as well, because this model with three factors can support up to eight unknowns, so we can add the A-B interaction, the A-C interaction, the B-C interaction, the A-B-C interaction, and you'll have a column for your intercept. So you multiply A-B, A-C, A-B, and so you can fill out these other four columns. I won't do that. And then the intercept column is always a column of ones. So this table of numbers, eight columns, eight rows, is your X matrix. And then you've also got over here your Y's, your single response that you measure from your experiments. So DOEs, as we learned in the undergraduate class, you only can work with a single response. So you'll measure Y1, Y2, and so on, up to Y8. So here you've got a Y vector that's 8 by 1. Here you've got an X matrix that's 8 by 8. And you can calculate the set of regression coefficients, beta, that relates those X's to the Y's using the standard X transpose X, inverse X transpose Y. So this gives you the relationship between the X's and the Y's. But we're saying here is you can do this with PLS as well. But why don't we use PLS in the undergraduate course? Why did we use least squares? Remember, we've been going on and on the whole time how least squares has so many advantages, sorry, how PLS has so many advantages over least squares. Why didn't I teach using PLS in the undergraduate class?
Just because everything's orthogonal between your design.
Yeah, so this matrix X is beautifully orthogonal. It meets the exact assumptions for least squares. Least squares says your X matrix is independent. Each column in X is independent of the other, basically saying it's orthogonal. And X's are measured without noise. So given that we set what A, B, and C are in our process, we can do that with pretty high accuracy. So we meet all those assumptions required for least squares. So analyzing your DOE data with multiple linear regression is an excellent tool. I'm not recommending you to move to PLS if this is your case. But in many real setups where we measure experimental data, you don't just collect A, B, and C and your corresponding Y. You also have a whole lot of other information, extra columns here. So I've run out of space on the board, so I'm just going to erase this column. But I'll, for example, while you're running those experiments, you might have the name of the operator. Let's call them operator A. A did that experiment, B did that experiment, B did that one, A did that one, B, A, A, B. And because you've done the undergraduate course, you've appropriately blocked for the operator effect. But then you've also maybe got the ambient temperature, which isn't really an experimental variable, but you just happen to record it while you're doing your experiments. And you maybe record several other columns of incidental information in your X matrix that are easily available from your process at that time. You don't expect these to have an effect on Y, because when you run your experiments, you do them in random order. That's why we mentioned the concept of randomization in the undergraduate class. You run these in random order so that these extra variables, which we typically call disturbances, so that they don't have any effect on your Y. That's why we randomize. But it doesn't hurt to record them and keep them. Now you can come and add these columns in using PLS into your data set and analyze them afterwards. And these columns will very likely be correlated because you've not gone and randomized these, or you've not gone and changed your disturbances. You've just measured these extra disturbances, but they could very likely be correlated to each other. So if you measure the temperature, you might measure the temperature of the chilled water as well as the ambient temperature. And those two variables might go up and down together, and so on. And what you're interested in, why we would analyze them in PLS, is because you never know. There might really be some effect from these disturbances onto Y that you never really thought of initially. Or when you ran your experiment, you didn't design your experiment with these variables as a factor. But because you can measure it, you can go analyze it after the fact. So that's why whenever people run DOEs, I say to them, record as much information as possible. You won't use it when you analyze your data using multiple linear regression. But if you want to analyze it using PLS, then you can easily do it. Furthermore, PLS is really, really beneficial when you've got multiple Ys. And that for most real systems, you do have many Ys. If you had to use multiple linear regression like we learned in the undergraduate part of the course, you have to go build a multiple linear regression model for each one of those. But when you're measuring your Ys and you've got several of them, there are going to be some sort of correlation amongst those Ys. So then your Y space model in PLS will pick up that correlation, and you've got it for free in your PLS model. So what I'll do here, this instances, I'll just show you a quick demo of it in the software. You don't have this data set. It wasn't on the notes, and I didn't have an exercise for it. So what I've just done here, though, is I'll just show you on a data set where this experimental design was done. So this was done on a minerals processing plant, and they've collected a whole lot of observations, and I'll show you the experimental tapping in the data in a minute. So these first three columns were the variables that were done in the design. Okay, so they have A, B, and C, and they didn't just do a factorial design. They also did the CCD design. So they had their center point, they had an axial point, they had the four corner points, and I'm just showing it for A, B, but there's also the C direction in the board. So there's one of these, there's an axial direction going this way, and then you've got your, you see why it's so messy, it's hard to draw, but you get the idea that there's about 16, 17 experiments that we've done here. So we've got way more than 17 rows. We've got about 400 of them, but I'll show you what's gone on here in a minute. So let's import the data, finish it up. So here you can see what's gone on. Here's the first variable. This would be factor A, the tonnage going in. So there's the first level, second level, third level. Well, this is a continuous process. So it's not like an ordinary experiment where you can just do the experiment today and then you continue on tomorrow with the next experiment. This is a continually operating process. So they have to do the experiment sequentially. And you change from one experimental condition to the other in random order. So that's factor A, there's factor B, and factor C. So if you were analyzing these data using multiple linear regression, you would have to go and say, I'm going to take the point somewhere then in the middle when it's steady state operation. So that will be your row in X over here. For example, this might be the plus minus minus condition for A, B, and C. You would have to go find the average operating point in the process data at that time for A, B, and C. Okay? And as you can imagine, it would be pretty hard to pick what an average is for some of these. Some of these experiments will run for only a few minutes before you transition to the next operating point. But because this is also an actual process, they don't just measure A, B, and C, they also measure these other process variables. And so you can see how the other process variables react to A, B, and C. These weren't designed. These were just other measurements that they could make on their process at that time. So these are exactly what we're going to, where PLS is perfect for. You add these as new columns into your X matrix. And then at the end, here's our Y variables. So these last three columns are our Y, and they were in this instance, for this plant, measurable online. So you could measure in real time for every one of those samples, you could also measure the corresponding experimental response rate. So that's why we've got more than 17 rows, but really this corresponds to 17 experiments that were done. So I'm going to say okay and save that, and I'll show you now one thing that one can do when you're analyzing EOE data. We've got these factors A, B, and C, but this, we know that from an orthogonal experimental design, we can also fit parameters A, B, A, C, B, C, and A, B, C. And in the undergraduate course, we often saw that these two-factor interactions were really interesting. They go beyond the main effect of A and give you some additional effect onto the response Y. So it would make sense then that we add a new column to the X matrix that's the product of A and B. So the software allows you to do that, and I'll just show you where you can. So you go to the expand tab, and here's A, B, and C. So tonnage in HS1 and HS2, that corresponds to A, B, and C. And you say, add for me the cross terms. So it will go and add in A, B, A, C, B, C as new variables for you. You can also add in the square terms. In this particular experiment, because they ran it in a CCD design, it supports A squared, B squared, and C squared as well. So you add in the square terms. So there's tonnage in squared, HS1 squared, HS2 squared. So it's calculating A, B, A, C, B, C, as well as A squared, B squared, and C squared for you by adding in those six new variables. Unfortunately, you cannot add in an ABC interaction. If you wanted to do that, you'd have to go do that manually outside the software. But very often the three factor interactions in most engineering systems are unlikely to be significant. So the two factor interactions and the square terms, those are excellent to add in initially. So let's go add those in. And then finally, I'll just go build the PLS model for you. So we exclude those three. I've done something that's caused the program to crash.
The OK sends a message. You have to hit
cancel
when it was
counted. Oh, no, I have to start all over. I think I can do quite fast. Anyway, you can see what I've done.
Sometimes if you don't click OK and you just click cancel, the program won't crash.
Oh, keeps going.
Yeah.
But then you never know what's accumulating.
Yeah,
yeah.
Exactly.
What I meant to go do was to go exclude the three y's, not the three x's. So exclude those x's, expand those, so add the square terms, add the cross terms, and create a new block for the three y's. Okay, so we've got our x, y, exclude those, we've got our expand. So I'll just fit two components here for you and then show you what's going on in the loadings plot and, more interestingly, what's going on in the score plot. So now you can see why this was a designed experiment. You can see these little clusters of operation. So there's about 16 or 17 of them as the process transitioned from one row to the other row. Obviously in random order, they did this in random order. And in fact, if you just plot the raw x's without the square and cross terms, these clusters are even tighter. They've spread out a bit more that I've added in those additional terms. But what's interesting here is in the W star C plot now, you can then go see which of the main effects, A, B, and C, as well as the which interactions are important. How would you do that? Well, you look here. So there's those two-factor interactions. But here you also see a whole lot of two-factor interactions. Actually, there's just two of them. They get almost zero weight, indicating that those two-factor interactions were not really important. That would be the equivalent of us plotting a Pareto chart from the multiple linear regression, and you see a small coefficient. These two-factor interactions have a small weight. Or the other way to plot it is to look at the coefficient plot itself. So let's go look for one of the y responses, plot up the coefficient plot, and we can see then that ton n was factor A, but we also see that one of these other variables, kr30n, was very related to that y variable. Now, it's not necessarily cause and effect here. The only thing we can say of cause and effect is that the tonnage n is definitely a causal variable. Maybe kr30n just goes up and down with that tonnage n. So this is the feed flow rate to the system. kr30n might be a variable that's ratioed with the tonnage n. If you put in 2 kilograms of the tonnage n, you have to put in 1 kilogram of a solvent or liquid or some other system. So it's no surprise that these two variables are strongly affecting the y, but only one of them is causal. Similarly here, you can go see the tonnage n squared coefficient. That's the effect of a squared is important. That's moderately important. This is the AB interaction. And then all of these terms are pretty small. Here's some of the other two-factor interactions. And here's HS1 was B. So B and B squared, those two factors are relatively important, unimportant to explaining this y. And you can go look at some of the other y's. So that was par one, FARY might show something quite the opposite. Yeah, in fact it does. It shows then that factor B is important for that y variable, but it wasn't important for the first y. So the nice thing about DOE data, when we get a DOE system and we get all this additional x variable information, now we can say there's cause and effect. when we're looking at the loadings plot. When we previously look at the loadings plot for other PLS models that's built just on the data that we happen to collect, we cannot say the one X causes the change in Y. But in a DOE setup, we can definitely say factors A, B, and C that we manipulated do have a causal relationship with Y. And that's much more powerful than just saying they're related. To be able to say they're causally related means that we can go do things like say, I want a certain Y value, how do I change my X's to get that Y? Now you can go turn the model the other way around and you can get a valid answer that way, which we're not normally able to do. Okay, so I just wanted to emphasize that point about DOE data. Then just another interesting thing is, just to mention it, don't be surprised if Q squared is very low for DOE data. Anyone want to guess why? Of course, if Q squared is low, it means that you shouldn't believe autofit, because autofit is going to stop the moment Q squared stops increasing. But with DOE data, I would fit the model by hand and not believe Q squared. Why do you think that might be? Think how Q squared was calculated. What was the thinking behind Q squared?
So if you have all these points that are like at extreme corner points of the space, then that's not really going to be a good prediction.
Yeah, exactly right. So say you've got the setup where you've got A, B, and C. So your X matrix in PLS at most contains, say, 8 rows. Say you're just analyzing these 8 experiments. It's a little bit different from the system we just looked at now, which comes from a continuous process. But say you just analyzed your 8 discrete experiments in PLS. When you do the leave out, when cross-validation is leaving out a group of observations, it's leaving out, for example, that corner and maybe that corner. So it's building a model based on these other 6 corners. Then it's testing the model by bringing these 2 observations back in again. So given that a DOE model really pulls your system far apart, it's not surprising that being able to predict those 2 corner points is really difficult. It's going to make a very poor prediction of those. And then on the next iteration, it's going to maybe leave out this data point and that data point. So it's building a model only of the rest of these observations, but not those 2 corners. So it really doesn't know what's going on in those areas when it's building a PLS model for that, in that iteration and cross-validation. So cross-validation on DOE data is really, take it with a grain of salt. Use more components than what cross-validation is telling you. I mean, some of the other software packages will fit 0 components, and they'll tell you there's no systematic variation in this data set. So don't believe that on the DOE data, because you know that there is systematic variation. It just happens that the observations it chooses to leave out can sometimes give you this thing that Q squared is 0.
If you add the principal components yourself, then it doesn't do any cross-validation?
No, if you go to the software, it still does the cross-validation. But
so there's no way to prevent it from leaving data out?
No, it will always do the cross-validation. But you can just keep saying,
because if you only had one run at each point, there's no way to force it to say, I want all these points.
No, I'm just forcefully adding in Q squared yet, and but you see how the diminishing returns?
Mm-hmm.
So whatever the algorithm that they've got in their software here that says Q squared stops after 2 components, it's because of that small incremental increase. It's not worth adding a whole new component for that. So while I'm saying it will still calculate Q squared for you in red, just ignore it.
But truly what you would want to do in a situation where you only have one run at each point is create a model with all of your points, right?
Oh, no. Cross-validation always does build a model with all the data. The model that's reported here at the end is the model of all the data.
Oh, Oh, right, okay.
Inside the cross-validation algorithm, it's doing 6 or 7 different models each time. Basically, every component is fitting G plus one models. It fits the G models plus the final model has all the data in it. Okay, so where I'm leading to with some of this is we've got our X matrix from, say, DOE, and then we add on to it some extra information. So within DOE now, the example I used was we add in columns for AB, AC, BC, and so on. We can always do that with any latent variable model. We can always add on to X any additional information that we know of. In the same way, when some of you guys are working on your distillation column models or your flotation model or whichever plant type you're working with, you have some first principles knowledge. So in wastewater treatment, you may know of certain principles that govern the physics of a wastewater treatment process. And those extra columns should be added onto X. I'm not so familiar with wastewater treatment, but in some other processes, we have the concept of dimensionless numbers. So you can calculate certain engineering quantities known as dimensionless numbers from the X matrix. So in the X matrix, you'll measure, say, X1, X2, and X3. And if you go read up in textbooks for the system that you're dealing with, you might find that there's a dimensionless number called D1 that's equal to X1 squared X2 divided by X3, for example. I mean, there's so many cases of dimensionless numbers, and they all have different ratios and powers of twos and threes, and some have fractional powers. Whatever the case is, you calculate this number, and you add that in now as a new variable into your X matrix. And very often, these will get much higher weights in the PLS model than the three individual X's. Because this dimensionless number, over the many years that engineers have been working on these systems, they've discovered that that dimensionless number is a very important quantity. So it's very often the fact that these dimensionless numbers get extremely high weight in PLS models and PCA models. It's because those engineers, when they've come up with those dimensionless numbers, have almost inadvertently discovered or defined the latent variable for that system. So if you have this additional information, always be sure to go read up some of the basic engineering books for the area you're studying. Go look at what the important equations are. There could even be things like mass balances or energy balances. So like on a wastewater treatment plant, rather than leaving in flow rate 1, flow rate 2, flow rate 3, which are the three different flow rates coming into your model, you could just add in a new column that's the sum of those flow rates in, and then you could have another column that's the sum of all the flow rates out. Okay. So add this in as a variable and add F in as a new variable in X. And you may choose to drop out those three flow rates later on, but at least initially, I always recommend leave them all in, right? PLS handles very highly correlated columns. That's what PLS is designed for. So immediately you know that flow rate 1, 2, and 3 are going to be very positively correlated with the inlet flow rate. So you're going to have four weights now that move up and down together, rather than just the three. But you might see that this weight gets far more weight than the three individually from F1, 2, 3. The other thing is, it might happen that X1 is a closer relationship to your Y variable when it is not X1, but rather maybe X1 square root. Your Y variable might have be a function of X1 square root. So rather add the X1 square root variable to your X matrix. Actually, what I often recommend here is to have two columns, have a column called x1 and have a column called x1 square root. So add in the raw data as well as the transformed data next to it. The reason for that is, okay, your y variable might be a strong relationship with the square root of x1, but x2 might have a stronger relationship with x1 by itself rather than the root. And since PLS is building a model for the x space as well as the y space, you want all the relationships in there as best you can. So again, we don't need to worry about having lots of extra columns and having this highly correlated x matrix. PLS handles that. You would never do this with multiple linear regression. You would never ask to have x1 and the square root of x1. You're almost asking for the x transpose x matrix to blow up on you. But in PLS, we don't really care. So I often say to people, at least initially, add in all the transformations you can think are important for your system. So like in a distillation column, it might be the log of a concentration that's more important than the concentration. Or very often we have things like 1 over temperature is more important than the temperature variable itself. So just add in both. Okay? So let me just quickly show you where that is in the software. It's also, I'll just use this data set that I've currently got loaded, although it's not really, this data set doesn't really need any transformations, but I'll just show you where to find it. You do all of that under variables. So for now, we've always just used this column. We haven't really paid any attention to these things over here, but that's exactly where you add these transformations. So for example, if you know that the PARM variable needs to be transformed in some way, you can go over here. Under the transformation option, there's several different transformation types. So don't worry, linear transformation will do nothing for you. I mean, it won't do anything for you. Any linear transformation will just be undone by mean centering and scaling. So don't bother with linear transformation. But let's say you need, actually this is a good example, this one here. If you take a look at the PARM variable, it's showing you the minimum value is 0 and the maximum is 68. Now, you know that log of 0 is undefined. So you can't just put in the software here, I want log PARM. It will definitely fail. So what you do is you first bias that variable up, say by 5 units, and then take the log of it. That will prevent you from taking the log of 0. All right, so all you're doing is you're shifting this variable that might be moving like that. You're just shifting it up a little bit and taking the log transform. So it's not, I mean, it's arbitrary what number you choose there. You just don't want to take the log of negative numbers. So let's choose the log transform for PARM. And now the software tells you, log. The software tells you it's going to take the log of A times the variable plus B. So A is equal to 1 and B is equal to 5. So just set B is equal to 5 and then you hit set. And you can see there now it's going to, rather than use the original variable, it will use the log with those settings of A and C. Okay. I don't think the software can have, after you've taken the transformation of this variable, you lose the raw variable, I think. I haven't checked that, but I don't think you can re-include PARM by itself. And then everything else proceeds as normal. You just say okay and rebuild the model, and now it would use the transformed variable for you instead of the raw data. Okay?
Maybe a stupid question, but if this signal or the data you're collecting is already conditioned using Schwarz chart or EWMA chart, then how this will handle? Or we have to really go for only raw data only?
No, you can add on to your X matrix any column you like. Right? So I think from what I understand you're saying is you've got a column here, so this is your X matrix, and you've got a particular column that has already been
conditioned.
Yeah, so it's for example, it's the output of a Schuart chart or the output of an EWM chart.
Sure.
It's like any other measurement, it's just being transformed in some way using a different algorithm.
Yeah.
I often advise people is add whatever you think is important onto X, because you will always see afterwards the loadings that is important or not. It will have a small weight if it's unimportant. Then you can go exclude it in the future. But it's very hard to tell before you do it that it's going to be important or not. So always just rather do it and then discover that it's unimportant, and then you can be sure, okay, there's no need for it. Okay, so do you want to just take a few minutes break, or do you want to?
Yes.
Yeah, let's take 5-10 minutes break and continue on that. This next section is was asked for by some students here. They're looking at some time series data. Now, time series is a whole branch of statistics that's super interesting. If you ever get a chance to go into it in more detail, I highly recommend it. It's very applicable to engineers and chemical engineers in particular. Time series analysis deals with modeling the effect of inputs onto a set of outputs. So if you, and you'll see this all over time series analysis, you kind of classify your process as a box. And this box could be anything. It could be your entire plant. It could be an entire country, and you're saying these inputs affect the country's output, and the output could be GDP and various other things. Or it could be as tiny as a single plate on a distillation column where the inputs are the flows from the previous tray and the outputs are the flows out to the next tray. It's arbitrary. You choose what you want to be inside your process. And time series analysis will build a model that relates those inputs X of T to the outputs Y of T. And so this is a collection of vector values over time. So you collect in time-based order, you create your X of T matrix, and your corresponding Y vector is created over time as well. And time series analysis is very, very interested in saying, as X goes from one time step to the other, T, we'll typically use the values XT, XT plus 1, XT plus 2. As this happens, and these inputs go through the process GP, you will get out YT plus 1, YT plus 2, and so on. So time series analysis will build various models, and they go by names like IMA or IRIMA, which is autoregressive integrated moving average, integrated moving average. And for those of you, in fact, that have taken the course, EWMA is an IMA11 model. So if you ever pick up time series analysis, the EWMA model is, in fact, one type of time series analysis model. So if you go look back at the EWMA course notes, you'll see me use notation like XT and YT, and I show you how one can predict YT based on previous values of X and T. So that's time series analysis. And it's tremendously useful in process control to design process controllers that say, given this input on my process, I expect that output, and then they're often used for feedback control to make sure that whatever input you get will give you the output you require. But they're also used a lot in forecasting, and if you ever look at economics literature, it's filled with time series analysis. And one of the gods of time series analysis is George Box, whose book we used in the course, Box, Hunter, and Hunter. He developed a lot of this original material, and he was also John McGregor's supervisor for his PhD thesis. And John is whose kind of course material I'm teaching to you. So, can we use latent variables for time series analysis? Yes, you can, but I would say I don't always recommend it. Time series analysis comes with a whole lot of tools that are far more systematic and very structured for doing that. Latent variables are a very kind of poor man's approach to time series analysis, but they do work well when you're where you've got many X's, many columns of X, and those X's are highly correlated. That's the one area of time series analysis that's not handled explicitly in the literature. So, and it may be, I just don't keep up with the time series analysis literature, but generally when you've got many X's and you relate them to one or more Y's, then maybe you can get away with a latent variable model that's dealing with time series data. But generally, I recommend you look at the time series literature first to see if your problem's been addressed there, rather than trying to fit your problem into a latent variable model. But I will go through here some of the principles we use when we try and use latent variable models for time series analysis. So let me just show you how you could use it on an extremely simple system. The first order system is given by that form in Laplace transform. So if you're not familiar with Laplace transform, don't worry about it. All this is the model for is a first order system that says if you give a process an input of x of s, or x of t would be the same thing, x of s would just be the Laplace transform version of it. You give that process GP is then modeled by the equation G is tau s plus 1, and then this would be your output y of t. So a first order system says that if you put an input in that has that shape, step response, so maybe this is could be a flow rate, for example, and you jump from some low level to some high level, your response you'll see on the other side would go from whatever it starts at, and then the moment that hits, at that same point, the system responds that way. And many engineering systems follow this pattern. You give it a step input, it will respond, and this is called a first order response. So that's the equation that defines what this input gives you, that output. If you want to see it in the time domain, the differential equation that governs that system is a simple dy/dt times this time constant, tau. And that time constant, incidentally, is, so here's the step input over here. Let me just mark it. That's when you took your step input. Tau is equal to that time that it takes to settle out is 5 time constants. So the time from there to there is approximately 5 times tau, for those of you that aren't familiar with this sort of stuff. And G is your gain. So it says that if you put in a unit input over here, this increase over here will be G units. So if you put in a step input of twice that, you will get 2G as your output. And also because it's a linear system, if you put in a step down, your response over here will be the same thing. You can go sample that time domain differential equation and generate a discrete time version of it. And that's where I'm interested in over here, because as process engineers, when you get your data in X and Y, you're not measuring continuous time data. You're going to measure Y of T at a particular instant, and Y of T minus 1 would be one sample back in time. So this comes back to this vector that we had up here earlier. So if you collect your vector y, this would be y of t, this would be y of t minus 1, this would be y of t minus 2, that entry. So we collect this data from our process databases. And what this model shows you here is you can predict or obtain the future y, the next y, if at time step t minus 1, you take the y value that you've recorded, multiplied by that coefficient delta, g times 1 minus delta, and then the x of t minus 1. So if you consider yourself here with, you've got two vectors, x and y, so here's x of t minus 1, and here's x of t. So if I take my x of t minus 1 value and my y of t minus 1, I've recorded that right now, okay? Multiply x t of minus 1 by g times 1 minus delta, multiply my y by that delta. I can predict y t one step ahead where that step ahead is delta t time units in the future. Sure. So as engineers, we measure our processes discretely. We don't measure continuous measurements. When you're looking at data that you collect from a system, you might collect it once per minute, once per hour, or maybe even more frequently or less frequently. But delta t is the sampling interval that you're collecting the data at. So imagine right now we're at 348, and our sampling delta t is equal to 1 minute. Okay? Oh, sorry, 1 minute. Repeat. Okay? So right now at 3:48 in the afternoon, we collect our x value, y, x of t minus 1, and we collect our y value, y of t minus 2. Y of t minus 1, sorry. At 3:49, now it's not 3:49 yet, but this equation shows that we can predict y of t, which would be at 3:49, by saying g times 1 minus delta times this x of t minus 1 value plus delta times y of t minus 1, and so on. And the system just keeps moving forward in time. So you can predict one step ahead in the future what your y of t is going to be. For any real system, your y of t will always be a function of the previous inputs. You can never have a system where y of t is a function of x of t. No, any input right now into a system takes some finite time to show up in y of t. Okay? So this is why always you'll see y of t on the left-hand side, and everything on the right-hand side will be t minus 1, t minus 2, t minus 3. There will be no terms in terms of t on the left-hand side. That's from a physics point of view. The reality is when you're dealing with data from a system, we don't go shift this column 1 up so that x of t minus 1 lines up with y of t. We assume that if I put an input into a process and I measure it, I just assume that it's going to be lined up like that. But the reality is most real systems, only the past can affect the future. You can't have the current point in time affecting the system. That's a small detail, so if you didn't get that, just gloss over it. And then generally, for any process, this is not for a first order, for any process, no matter how complex, you can write y of t is a function of previous y's. So y t minus 1 times a coefficient, y t minus 2 times its coefficient, up to some finite number of steps in the past. It could be 3, 4, 5, 6, it doesn't matter. The point being is that these coefficients generally approach 0. So your long past doesn't affect your current point in time. There's a finite effect from your past operation onto your current operation. And then we've got terms for the x variable, so b1 times xt minus 1, b2 xt minus 2. Again, a finite number of past inputs from the x affect your y. So that's interesting, because what we're saying is previous y's affect our current y. Okay, that kind of seems weird. You could understand, okay, your x is your input, affect your y, but these systems where you say previous values of y also affect my y, they're called autoregressive systems. They're systems that say they depend on themselves. And that's simple to understand if you think of a process that's very slow moving. For example, like the stock market. Within 1 hour, the stock market doesn't move radically. Okay? Previous values of the stock market are very strong predictors of the stock market the next few minutes from now. Okay, if the stock prices are generally moving up, the momentum in the system keeps them moving up. Okay, only very strong changes in your inputs will cause the outputs to change. Or a classic example of a slow moving process would be a wastewater treatment plant. You've got very large tanks. Any input, a new input in X, takes a very long time before it shows up in Y. So the easiest way actually to predict Y is to say, I'm going to use my previous values of y. They're actually far more predictive of my future values of y, because the process moves so slowly. So if you kind of find this weird that past values of y affect the current value of y, it, from an engineering process, or from a modeling point of view, it makes sense. It may not seem sensible from a mechanistic point of view, but when we model these systems using equations like this, it works really well. And the key point here is that we can say an output y is a function of previous x's and previous y's. That's really what I want to get across here. Now, here's why latent variable models are not so good for time series analysis. Ordinary time series models deal with that sort of relationship between the past x's and past y's very, very well. But in a latent variable model, where you've got an x matrix and a y matrix, say, let's just deal with PLS. These rows in x and y are now time-based. So this is row x1, x2, x3, up to xt, and then you've got row xt plus 1, xt plus 2, and so on in x. Interestingly enough, in PLS and in PCA, if I go reorder these rows, as long as I'm consistent, if I move row 1 down to the bottom and then I move row 7 up to the top, I randomly go shuffle the rows around, I will get the same model if I rebuild the PLS model. Okay? The same holds for PCA. You can go reorder your rows in PCA and build your model. It makes no difference. You'll get exactly the same loadings, exactly the same coefficients. That's interesting because it says that you've gone and carefully ordered your rows by time, but it's actually meaningless. You could have ordered them back to front and you would have still gotten the same model. So it indicates to you that what PLS and PC are doing is they're not modeling the dependence from one row to the other row. PCA and PLS, all that they're modeling is the relationship actually between the columns. They don't care about the order of the rows. They don't even care about the order of the columns, but what a model, a latent variable model does, is it's modeling the relationships between the columns. It's not modeling any relationships between the rows. Okay? So time series models, on the other hand, they're very, very much concerned about the relationships between the rows. In other words, the rows go from one time step to the other. That's exactly what a time series model is doing. A latent variable model doesn't really care what's in your rows. You could reorder them any way you like. So how do we get the time series model to care about time or time-based information? We add new columns to X. So in today's class, I've been speaking a lot about adding these new columns to X. So we're going to use this approach as well. We're going to add new columns of X to get your time-based information. So this is what we do. So ignore this guy over here for now. We're just focusing on the system on the left. And imagine it's this first order system where we're saying our Y of T is A1 times a previous value of Y plus B1 times a previous value of X, plus some disturbance, which is also a function of the time. So this D of T is some disturbance that's kind of coming in over here. So A1 times Y of T minus 1 and B1 times X T of T minus 1, that's our first order model. That's the equation for a first order system. That's what's coming out over here. Plus D of T is some sort of disturbance that's just additive, and we're collecting that as our y. So if you wanted to build a model in using latent variable methods, you would put x of t minus 1, d of t minus 1, and that would predict your y of t. But how do we handle that term over there? So we've handled this term here, x of t minus 1, that's our x column. Our d of t minus 1, that's that column. How do we handle the first term? All we do actually is we take our y variable we shift it up one time step and we plug it over into the X. Okay? So now you see what's happening is that this block over here was, have I messed this up? I have messed this up. This should have been shifted down now that I'm looking at it. Yeah, that should have been shifted down. I messed my figure up. Yep, this was done late last night. Okay, let me draw it on the board what the figure should be, and you can correct your notes. So this should be x of t minus 1, and then this column will be d of t minus 1, and this column will be y of t minus 1 if you shift it down. Okay? Because what's going on here is we've taken y of t, this would be y of t minus 1, y of t minus 2 would be over here. So yeah, by shifting it down, that term goes there, that term lands up there. Okay. So this would be y of t over here. So now in PLS, when we build our model, we make this our X matrix. Okay, so this now becomes X. So we throw this away, we throw that observation away, and we throw that observation away. And this becomes our Y. It goes from here to here, and we throw that observation away. So now within one row, we've got x of t minus 1, d of t minus 1, y of t minus 1. And when PLS builds a model, it's going to build, you can visualize it as y equals x times beta. Beta is going to contain the regression coefficients here. It's going to contain a regression coefficient for x. It's going to contain a regression coefficient for d. And it's going to contain a regression coefficient for y. That would be... Oh, actually, let me write in these terms really. It would contain A1 over there, B1 over here, and actually this should probably be a coefficient there. Let's just call it B1. So PLS is going to build your predictive model that relates X, D, and Y to the next step ahead of Y. So that's how you force a latent variable model to build a time series information. You have to add to your X matrix new columns that contain these additional terms. So if you say, I assume my process is second order, you write out, go to your process control textbooks, or Dr. Marlin's textbook is a good example, that shows how to take a second order model and write it out in time-based form. And then you'll see, okay, a second order model requires that I go up to x of t minus 1 and an x of t minus 2. I need two previous x's. So you go add two columns of x, and you might need two previous columns of y. And then you figure out how many lags to add. But I'll show you a different way to figure out how many lags to add. That could be one way, is to go use your theoretical knowledge and add those additional columns to x and y. But I'll move on to the next section, which will show you how to also lag. So this concept of shifting a column and adding it is called lagging. Okay? And
what happens if you have multiple disturbances?
Sorry?
If you have multiple disturbances, not one.
So if you can measure all those disturbances,
add as a column,
you would have those columns in X. But very often we cannot measure all our disturbances, and that will just show up as error. Right, so we can't model it. There's nothing to assign it to. Okay, so how many lags do you add? Well, let's take a look here at we can use the autocorrelation function. So this was an example from the course notes where we had this kappa number, and here's the time-based data. So plotted in time samples, this would be y of t plus 1, y of t plus 2, y of t plus 3. And you can see here in the raw data that there is a pretty strong relationship between one observation and the next. If one observation is high, the next one's also high. And what the autocorrelation plot tells you is how long does it take for that dependence amongst the observations to die out? And it's telling us here that 1, 2, 3, so lag 0 will always be 1. But lag 1, 2, 3 are significant. After lag 4, it's insignificant. There's a little reappearance, and then there's another reappearance further down. It could be due to feedback control that's taking a long time. So 3 lags are significant in this process. So it's telling you y of t is a function of y of t minus 1, y of t minus 2, and y of t minus 3. After that, the coefficients are pretty much 0. So if you go back to this general form here, you would only need an a1, an a2, and an a3 coefficient. After that, a4, 5, 6, 7 are pretty small. Okay? So you would then have to go and add this column. So I've got this the wrong way around. You need to shift it down. But you need to go do it 3 times. You need to go have 1 shift, 2 shifts, and then 3 shifts. So you've added 3 extra columns to your X matrix. Okay? Now, you can go do exactly the same with PLS. What I've gone and done here, and you'll do this in the exercises in a minute, is I've gone and added a column to my X matrix, I've added 20 columns to my X matrix, which is just the previous columns of Y. And you can then build a model that says Y of T is, and then my X matrix was only other previous lags of y. I had no other x variables. I just put y of t minus 1, y of t minus 2, up to y of t minus 20. Build a PLS model and you'll get exactly the same. Okay. So not very useful, but it shows that PLS gives you at least the same results as time series models. What's more interesting here is how to bring in the x variables. And I hope I've shifted this the right way. I think I have. looking at it. Anyway, and there's always this, I'm not the only one that gets this wrong. Everyone I've seen present this stuff, they always get it mixed up. So if you need few previous values of x, so in this case we're building a model y as a function of x t minus 1, with x 2 steps in the past, x 3 steps in the past. You would then put your y variable here, and then your x's, you shift that same column of x. You just copy and paste it and shift it over. And like I said, I think I've got it the wrong way. I may have had to shift down instead of up. But the point is that after the end of this, you're going to have within one row exactly the data that you need, because PLS and PCA don't care about the order of the rows. So you have to make sure that what's in your rows are consistent amongst each other. And then you would build your PLS model, and one of the first things that you look at are your loadings plots and your coefficient plots, because that will tell you which lags were important. Right? So in this case, I've added 10 lags of that variable. I'm predicting this y based on one of the x variables that I've lagged 10 times. So in fact, over here, let me just explain this for a second, what this graph is showing me. I have a single y and I have a single x. And in my x space in PLS, I've got a column which is x of t minus 0. I've got a column for x of t minus 1, which is this same column just shifted. I have a column xt minus 2, and so on, up to xt minus 10. So my x matrix actually is extremely correlated. I've got these columns which are identical to each other, they're just shifted every time. This one is shifted one unit up, this is shifted 2 units up, this is shifted 3 units up, and so on. And then my y vector is just what it was originally. Once you build that PLS model, you can get your regression coefficient that says y hat is equal to x, which is now a matrix, times beta. So there's a regression coefficient here that shows the effect of every x onto Y. And you can see which are the important lags there. So in this case, lag 3 and lag 4 were the important lags. Lag 0, which was the data that you recorded, at the same time you record Y, you record lag 0, shows very small relationship. It's in fact only 3 steps into the past that X is important for the Y. And that's true for many real engineering systems. You put an input into a process, okay, G, so you've got your input X, and it may take up to however many sampling periods before that X starts to show up as being related to Y. In this case, it takes somewhere between 3 and 4 sampling intervals before your input X shows any strong correlation with Y. So using your PLS model, you just add many, many lags, then see which lags are important to go figure out which lag should I use. Then once I've got this, I figure, okay, 3 and 4 lags, 3 and 4 are probably the most important. I'll go drop out lags 0, 1, 2, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and I'll just keep lags 3 and 4. Those seem to be the most strongly related to my Y variable, and I'll keep those in. And I think you're probably asking, why just lags 3 and 4? Why don't you just leave all of them in? Okay? Yeah, you could do that, but I'll show you why in a minute. After you drop these out, the coefficient for lag 3 and 4 will become very, very strong. They'll become even larger still, because PLS has to put the weight somewhere. So it's going to put them on the important variables. Okay, so that's in a nutshell the concept of lagging, and I'll show you when we get to the software exercise how to add the lags and how to interpret them. So just before we get there, I just want to cover these few points on simulation systems as well as the causality and feedback control. So I'll go through this one quite quickly because we spoke about this last week. Causality was that topic, remember when we were looking at this cheddar cheese example, where we built the least squares model. This is the least squares model that shows, take 20 times the lactic acid value, 3.9 times the H2S value, and 0.31 times the acetic acid, minus that coefficient, and you'll get your predicted value, your taste. We showed then that the regression coefficient for acetic acid was extremely small, so you could drop that variable out of your system. In fact, your lactic acid coefficient is also pretty close to zero. That's almost spanning zero. So you could kind of say, well, it is important, but maybe it's not that important. And in fact, what I did, just to go check it, I dropped out both acetic acid and lactic acid, rebuilt the model just using H2S. That confidence interval for H2S now becomes much stronger, much narrower. And the prediction error is roughly the same. So it shows whether you use all three of your X's or just a single one of those X, you can predict what your taste value is. So the coefficient changes a little bit. And in fact, one other thing I did that I haven't shown here is I rebuilt the model using only acetic acid to predict the taste, and then another model using only lactic acid to predict the taste. And all three of those D-squared values predict the taste pretty well. Okay, the lactic acid model is a little worse than this one, and the acetic acid is a little worse than the lactic acid model, but the predictions aren't bad, right? So it shows you could use any one of your three X's, you could use two of them, you could use all three of them. Okay, so you're not really learning here what's causing the Y, because you're showing any one of the three Y's could have caused that. Any one of the three X's could have caused the Y. PLS, this equation I know is incorrect, but I think that coefficient is wrong. The rest of this is probably correct, but PLS will show you each of the X's get roughly the same weight. So the PLS model gives equal weight to each of the X's. So which one is right? There's, like we discussed last week, none of them are really correct in any sense of the word. we don't know actually what the true cause and effect mechanism is here. What influences the judge's taste, whether it's H2S, lactic acid, acetic acid, or whether it's some balance of those three properties. We don't know the true cause and effect in the system. But this concept applies to any empirical model, not just to this particular cheese example. Any system where you just collect data from your process. You go to your database and collect the last 2 years of data and you build your model, you're going to get this sort of problem. You cannot say these X's cause that Y, because there's been no systematic design of experiments. The only time you can infer cause and effect is when there's been a DOE done, because then you've gone and changed your X's independently. Here you're just saying, at best, they're correlated with each other. Now take a look at this, just to kind of emphasize it a bit. Say you've got this new cheese. Remember, when we built the model, all the three values moved up and down together. But now let's take a new cheese with high lactic acid, low H2S, and high acetic acid. Okay? Multiple linear regression will predict 25.5 as the taste value. And using this model over here, with just H2S, it predicts 13. And PLS, I think this is wrong, but it predicts some large, strange number. Okay, that's the main point. So again, which model is going to be the best? Yeah. The average of the three. The point is, none of them are going to give you the correct answer. And the difference is, PLS will warn you that that's the incorrect answer because it will give you a high SPE value because those three properties are now not synchronized anymore. And the reason why none of them are correct is because the correlation structure is broken. Okay? And this is what I really want you to remember from this class is when you build a model, it's relevant for the correlation structure that was in the data when you built the model. Okay? If the correlation changes in the process later on, you have to rebuild that model. So let me draw a picture to try and explain that a bit more. You collect, so here's your process, and over this is time. Over time, your process is evolving. And it happens that you've gone here, let's say from 2002 to 2005, and you've collected some data on your process, and you've built a PLS model based on that. Okay? We're asking here, is the PLS model valid in this period of time? Is the PLS model going to be valid in this period of time, 2007? Or even over here, up to 2010, 2011. Does the model work in the future?
Depends if you are running in the same situation, same condition.
Yeah, exactly right. If the correlation structure over here or any time in the future matches the situation, this is when you built the model, you'll be fine. Okay, and how do you know the correlation structure is the same?
The coefficients.
How do you check, it's now 2011, how do you check that the correlation structure in 2011 is the same as 2002 to 2005?
Sorry? Would you build the model again?
No, we're saying rebuild the model if the correlation structure has changed. So how do you know the correlation structure has changed?
You test the model.
SPE. You test the new observations. You bring in your data from 2011. If the SPE is below the limit, you know that it still matches the correlation structure when the model was built. There's no need to rebuild the model. Only as SPE starts to trend higher and higher and higher, then it's saying, hang on, there's, I'll get you in a minute. So here's 2002,
2005, and here's your SPE limit. So you built your data during this period of time. Now it's 2006 and it works, 2000. But okay, of course in between every now and then you're gonna have a data point with high SPE, but we expect that this is a 95-99% limit. But you're seeing this in SPE over time, it's clearly telling you something's going on. Yeah. And here you stop, rebuild your model, because it's showing you've got this indication that things are not consistent with this period of time.
Yeah, you guys?
Yeah.
What if it's not your model that's the problem, or if it's this something, equipment or something, like something you haven't recorded in the next value?
Good point. If it's something that you haven't recorded, then the model doesn't know about it either, right? So again, your predictions might be off, consistently going, if you're testing your prediction, say, against a lab value, initially you're getting pretty good predictions, but over time your predictions are getting worse, yet your SPE is still below the limits, that would be a clear indication to me I've left something out of my X matrix. Again, it's time to rebuild, trying to think what should I add to X to make it relevant and capture that phenomenon. I'll show another example of that here in the notes coming up, where if something's left out initially, the model has no idea about it, so it's not going to build a model that's adequate for it. Yeah. Okay. So the point is, we've got an excellent tool to test if the correlation structure is still broken, but none of these models can be used to, say, predict the taste of a new cheese that's totally inconsistent. If you bring in this new cheese, its SPE is way off the model building data. You cannot use it to predict what that cheese's taste is going to be like. What you would need to do, in fact, is you need to go, we've got three variables here, you need to go build a 2^3 factorial, you need to create 8 cheeses which have in your factorial system high acetic acid, high lactic acid, high H2S. Go create 8 new cheeses, have your judges taste these cheese, and then you have a cause and effect model that says lactic acid affects taste in this way, H2S affects taste in that way. Now this is not feasible for engineering processes, especially when our X space is many, many columns. Okay? So we can almost never say with certainty in engineering processes there's cause and effect. What we can say with cause and effect though is if we add our process knowledge to the plots. Okay? This is an important point. Normally we cannot say cause and effect. We can only say there's correlation amongst the variables. But as engineers, we know certain cause and effect mechanisms exist in our process. Right? Let's come to this example where there's conversion, and we know from our system that to increase conversion, one way to do that is to increase the flow rate into this reactor, or to increase one of the temperature variables. We might know that from engineering principles. We see the correlation as well in the loadings plot. Okay? We see that temperature and the flow rate are positively correlated with the conversion. So then we can be pretty sure that this is a cause and effect mechanism as well as a correlation. But let's take this. Z2 is negatively correlated with conversion. Z2 just happens to be the distance along the reactor. You wouldn't say to your engineering colleague, oh, let's go change Z2. Well, it's not a variable even that you can change, right? Okay. What you would need to change is you need to increase the flow rate. That causes Z2 to decrease, which also causes conversion to decrease. So you have to bring your engineering knowledge of cause and effect together with the correlation knowledge you're seeing in the loadings. Then you can infer cause and effect. But even still, you're only relying on your engineering knowledge. If you're uncertain about it, you would still need to resort to a design experiment. Okay? So if you're not entirely sure that the flow rate is what's increasing the conversion, you best do the designed experiment. Because actually, there's many cases like this in engineering, you see this all the time, where you go increase the flow rate and conversion goes up. So, well, that's cause and effect. You go decrease the flow rate 2 days later and conversion goes down. Now, again, I'm sure this is cause and effect, but it's not. Because probably what's happening, or as an example, what could be happening, when the flow rate increases, the operator sees a higher flow rate and goes and makes some other adjustment to the process. It's not recorded here. And then as the flow rate drops, the operator also goes and makes the opposite adjustment to the process. It might be whatever the operator is adjusting that's really the cause and effect mechanism. So the operator's change is not here in the data. And that is the cause and effect. You're always seeing this positive correlation, but it's not a cause and effect correlation. Okay? So be careful, even with interpreting these plots with your engineering knowledge, it might not be always what you think. There's an excellent example of one of these in Ox Hunt and Hunter's book. I forget which chapter and the page section, but if you email me, I can point you to it, where he describes a case where this exact happened. You see these two X variables move together, but there's really a third variable that's the true cause and effect mechanism that's driving the process. That's just not recorded in the data. So be aware of that as well. Okay, so we've discussed this about rebuilding the model. And then this last point here, I'll just mention this, is you'll often see that if you've got several X variables that are highly correlated with each other, so the classic example is a distillation column, where if you're measuring temperatures of every tray, so if you're just looking at the top of the column, you've got your distillate leaving, and you've got temperatures of all these trays, these temperatures are all positively correlated with that distillate concentration. Now, in the PLS model, what you'll see for these temperatures, so here's temperature, it's called temperature 1 up to temperature 5, so temperature 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, and then here's the concentration. What PLS does is these temperatures are positively correlated to concentration. So it will go put a weight on that variable, a weight on that variable, a weight on that variable. We'll put roughly equal weight on all five variables. Okay? What happens if you go rebuild the model using only temperature 1 and temperature 5? So you drop these three variables out. What do you think might happen in PLS? What would
it go up?
Exactly. So weight 1 and weight 5 become important. They're still showing a positive correlation with concentration, but it's now spread this effect over two variables rather than five. Remember, the weights are always constrained to have unit length.
Why not stay the same?
Because say these were the only variables in your model. We have that constraint that W transpose W must equal to 1. So the sum of squares of these weights must always add up to 1. So if you've got 3 fewer, these must go up to compensate to meet that constraint. Okay. Also, as you would guess, if you only had just temperature 1, then this would become an even stronger weight. Okay. So multiple linear regression was like that cheese example. We had 3 positively correlated X's, the lactic acid, the H2S, and the acetic acid. We saw that multiple linear regression gave high weight to 2 of them and gave no weight to the third. And you also saw there that when I rebuilt the model with just 1 of the X's, it gave a high weight to 1 of the X's. Okay? So, and the same prediction ability. PLS, when it sees several correlated variables that are related to each other, it will go and spread out the weights across all the variables. So just be aware of that sometimes. If you see whole groups of similar variables with similar weight, it's an indication that you could maybe use the average temperature as a new variable. I don't recommend you do that. I often just recommend you leave the raw X's in there. Okay. Just accept that, mentally treat this as one thing. Mentally treat this as one effect, it's the temperature effect at the top of the column. So when you interpret the loadings plot, you just interpret it a little differently. Okay, for this next section, I was talking about that paper that I asked you to download. So this was a PDF. I highly recommend you go read it, especially for the first 5 or 6 pages. You'll definitely be able to understand what's going on here. There's nothing too technical. They cover cross-validation, how to handle missing data. I'll let you read the paper and interpret that plot there, which shows these are the predictions from a PLS model, and this is the predictions from a least squares model. So I'll let you read the paper to see why those predictions are a little bit strange like that. But what I want to get to is this point here about having good variation in your X data. What happened here was there's two cases, and I think a few of you in the class are working on projects where you're using data from a simulation software like Aspen or HiSys or something like that, and then you're using those models afterwards. This will be applicable to you. So when you're using these software packages, they've got all sorts of complicated first principles models, and it says, as a black box, you've got your process here, and given several inputs, it will generate one or more outputs for you. What John McGregor and Tom Marlin and Jim Krester showed in this paper was that if your inputs here don't match the reality very closely, you'll get poor predictions. So what they did was they built two data sets. They built data set X1 and data set X2, and then they used each of these to relate to a Y. So they built two PLS models. Okay. The first model used X1, and X1 was generated using the simulator that only had variation in the manipulated variables. So this process was a distillation column, and they only put in variability in the manipulated variables. So here's a distillation column. The manipulated variables were the feed flow rate of the water, as well as the reboiler duty. They only, when they generated the X matrix, put in variability in those flow rates and that duty. Of course, that affects all the X's and the temperatures and so on in the column, which also then affects the purity and the output and the purity of the bottom. But on a real distillation column, there would also be variability in the disturbances. So the feed flow rate over here would be variable. The feed composition would be changing. So it's not always a perfect split like 0.66, 0.3, 0.04. Feed temperature and the solvent temperature. So when they generated X2, they had variability in the manipulated variables and the disturbance variables. Their first data set only had variability in the manipulated variables. So they built two separate PLS models. Then they had a testing data set. Their testing data set had variability in the manipulated variable and the disturbance variable. So what would you expect to be the predictions? Y hat, when you use the first PLS model. Would you expect good predictions, poor predictions? Poor predictions. And if you use your second PLS model, it matches more what reality is. Okay? So that was, it seems a little bit of an obvious conclusion, but it's not entirely that unobvious, because many times when we build our models, we don't always take into account all the variability that will be there in the future. Let me just quickly show you the results and then I'll explain the point. So this was the result from the first PLS model, using only manipulated variable disturbances. And then this is the result from the second PLS model that has both types of disturbances in it. So what's happened in the first PLS model is that loadings, so remember, PLS model will just generate a set of loadings here for you. We're going to get W star vectors for each model. This PLS model that only has variability in the manipulated variable is going to have low weights for for the variables that are related to the disturbance, because it doesn't see any disturbance variability. Whereas this model over here, which has the same number of columns in X as this one, the weights are going to be slightly different. There's going to be weights in here that explain how the disturbances also affect Y. This model has no knowledge that there's any effect from the disturbances onto the Y. So certain columns are going to be zero in here, particularly the columns that are related to the effects of the disturbances. Because it doesn't know that there's any disturbances. This model over here is going to have non-zero values for those weights that are related to the variables from the disturbance effect. And of course, then the predictions are going to be much better, because this case matches more closely how it will be used in the future. So that's the key point. It's not just relevant for people working with simulations, but for anyone. When you build a PLS model, it should match the conditions under which you're going to use it in the future. That's kind of sounds obvious, but it's very often that we omit certain important features in this X matrix. Or when we build a classic case is coming to this idea of, say you're using your data from 2002, and here's 2003. I only build my model using data from January to May, when it's winter time. So it's no surprise then, come June, July, August, September, October, when it's warmer outside. So here's January, here's May, here's October, here's SPE. Things go nicely, and then do that. I've made this mistake many times when I've worked on distillation column models. You use data from these 5 months, it's insufficient variation in your data. You don't capture all the conditions under which the model is going to be used in the future. So the thing to learn from this is use enough rows in X that captures all the variability you expect to see now and in the future, so that your model is going to be relevant. Unless you're just willing to accept that you're going to have to keep rebuilding your model every so often. Every time you see high SPE, you're going to stop, rebuild. That gets messy in an industrial situation, but you don't have time to do that. So to do it right the first time is make sure you capture enough variation to go into your X matrix to build a decent model. So this is called model excitation. You excite the model in all the areas that it needs to be relevant for. This was this topic of noise that was brought up earlier here. So what they also did was that they generated another data set called noise-free data set. So this was from a simulator. You can generate all your X's with no noise. Then they had another second data set. This is with noise. So this is noise-free, and this is with noise. Built two PLS models again. And what they've done here is they've gone and shown you what the weights look like. Well, actually, sorry, this is the coefficients. They're showing you here beta for the noise-free case. So beta noise-free and beta with noise. So the solid blocks are no noise, and the diamonds are with noise. So this is the weights for the temperature profile, and there's almost no change in those. But when they went and added noise onto the flow rates and onto the temperatures, of course, there's little change in these weights, but here's really where you see the change. This was a single column called the Q, the reboilability. It had a very strong negative weight when there was no noise in the model. As you added 10% noise, the weight decreased. And if you added 30% noise, the weight became smaller. You've got similar effects with some of the other. So it's showing you here that the noise has corrupted some of the signal in the model. So PLS will place less weight on these noisy variables. So the weight becomes smaller and it starts distributing it to some of the other variables a little bit. So if you're using simulated data, try to match as realistically as possible the data you're generating to how you're going to use it in the future. Conversely, you can learn from this that when you collect data on a real system with noise, the true effects might actually be hidden if the variables you're measuring are very noisy. If the variables are very noisy, PLS is going to put less and less weight on them. That would be the converse if you measure on a real system. But what they've got here is they've gone on a simulated system and then corrupted it with noise. But you learn the same thing. And then finally, this is a very, very interesting thing. I think this always surprises people sometimes. What they did here was they were building a soft sensor, right? That was their objective for this distillation column in this paper. So you've got your temperature profile again, and what they're predicting is the concentration of the distillate. So they, in the paper, they call it XD, would be the Y variable. XD is just a chem-eng notation for the purity of the distillate. It's a little bit confusing because it's an X, so I'm just going to call it D. And in fact, their Y variable was log D. So in the software, they took the log transform of the Y variable. That's what they're trying to predict, based on all these other X's of temperatures and flow rates and so on. When they do it in the simulator, which is something you can't always do in a plant, is they could simulate this process in open loop. So they have no feedback control on this distillation column. So they collected a data set which was open loop, and they collected a data set with closed loop, with feedback control. And so you're seeing here, again, the coefficients of the model. Open loop would be the triangles, and with feedback control would be the X's. Now, as an engineer, you would look at this loadings plot and you see which X's are related to which Y's. What's very interesting here is that the moment you close the loop, some of your regression coefficients switch sign, which tell you what was positively correlated is now negatively correlated. Okay, so you're learning something that's very opposite, but it's the same system. Why are we saying now suddenly these temperatures are now positively correlated, whereas before in open loop they're negatively correlated?
But no more feedback control.
Yeah, so feedback control has gone and flipped the correlation, which again emphasizes to you that you can't look at cause and effect in these models, because the cause and effect doesn't change. When you add a feedback controller, the laws of physics don't suddenly change. Feedback control just modifies the correlation structure on the variables. So you're seeing now opposite symbols. For those of you that are kind of scratching your heads on why feedback control would flip the sign, imagine just a quick crash course in process control. You've got your process here, GP, and it has a positive gain. What I mean by that is if you put in a step input that's positive, your output is positive as well. If you put in a step that goes down, your output goes down. So GP has a gain that's positive. Okay? Now, that's our process. We're controlling this Y to a certain target, and we call it the set point. So here's where we would like to have Y, but then for whatever reason, Y starts to drift upwards due to some disturbance, some change in the process. So what we do is we measure that Y, we bring it back around here, we compare it to the set point, we say Y set minus Y, so Y set minus Y gives us a negative number. Okay, we put that into a PI controller. We put in a PI controller must always have the same gain as the process. So GP and GC must have the same sign. So this has got a positive sign. So if you put in a negative number, you're going to get a negative out here. So this is our input X. So it says the moment this becomes positive, X needs to go negative so that it drives this back to where you want it to be. So now you see why the signs change. Because when this is high, that is low. But in open loop, when this goes up, this input X goes up, your output Y would also go up. So in open loop, the input x is positively correlated to the output y. But in closed loop, when this is high, your output is low. When your output is high, your input is low. So now they're negatively correlated in closed loop. So no surprise then that when you're going to feedback control, some of your signs and your correlation structure switch around. Again, emphasizing you cannot infer cause and effect from these latent variable models. They're just modeling the control structure, the correlation structure for you. And once you add a feedback controller to your system, the correlation structure is changed. Okay? So if this baffles you, don't worry. I don't always, I understand it, but John McGregor wrote his PhD thesis on this topic with George Box on why that, and proved why it's always the case. It's not an obvious answer, let's put it that way, why this happens. But the main point is here, what can you learn from this? Well, it's actually interesting. Why do we build soft sensors to predict these whys? We build soft sensors to predict these whys because they're difficult to measure or expensive to measure. But what this is telling us is that when you collect your data to build a soft sensor, and we usually build our soft sensors so we can implement feedback control afterwards on them. It says you need feedback control in place in order to build a soft sensor for feedback control. Okay, that's not helpful. Now you're saying you need to have this to get that. So what they show in this paper, and you can read a bit more about it, is you can do it in iterations. So collect your data under open loop, use your model for feedback control, then recollect some data in a closed loop when the correlation structure is different and rebuild your model, and you may have to do that 2 or 3 times. Okay? So it's a very interesting paper, which is why I selected it for you guys to read a bit more. There's tons of other interesting papers on the website that I gave you at the start of the class, but I would recommend this one at least. Okay, well, we've run out of time. So I've got one case study for today's class. You're welcome to leave. If you need to go, I know a few of you said you need to go by 5 o'clock, but I will go through the case study now as well. So, everyone okay with that? Yeah, okay.
You're gonna have to rebuild your model and your controller also, right?
Yeah, so they make the point that they showed in their paper, they built the model under cascade control and under feedback control. The PI feedback control. Both of them are feedback controllers of different types. The PI and the cascade model didn't change much in their coefficients from each other. They were very different from the open loop case to the closed loop case. In fact, I can just show you that quickly. So there was the model for the feedback controller. So notice the open loop follows this pattern like that, okay? And this is the closed loop. Now look, compare that to the plot one down. The open loop is still the same, but this is the cascade controllers. This is very similar to the previous other closed loop controller. But yeah, I would learn from this, controller retunings, not an issue. Major changes, yes. Where I've seen this and it's caught me up was when I was working with Petro-Canada, and I built the model using data from 2002 to 2005. Then it worked on their process for a while. They shut down in the summer for 1 month, and they cleaned out their distillation column. When they brought the column back online, the model worked, but with high SPE, not because of the feedback controller. They didn't change the feedback controller tune, but by cleaning out the column, things had changed slightly. So all it needed was minor retuning or minor rebuilding to get it back up. Right. So it would be the same here. If you minor change in the controller tuning, your SPE might shift up a little bit on average. But a big change, yeah, you need to rebuild. So the exercise that I have for you is on this digester. It's a pulp digester in the pulp and paper industry. They feed wood chips to a big, big reactor type device. So I'm not going to draw this correctly, but it's not the shape. But generally, what you use, you feed wood chips in here, plus an alkali medium, and at the bottom you withdraw pulp. So this alkali medium impregnates the wood chips, it softens it up, breaks it down, and at the bottom you withdraw this big mashy pulp mess. What you also do is you feed countercurrent to that flowing upstream is fresh alkali. So fresh alkali goes this way and comes out over here. So countercurrent processes are common in chemistry. There's about a 4-hour delay between the wood chips over here coming in. They move through in plug flow form very slowly. And this reactor is actually partitioned in 4 different regions. So these wood chips move through each of these regions and they come out here as pulp about 4 hours later. And on the pulp they measure a number, which are a Y, is called kappa. And that's the kappa is just a quality measure of the pulp. So it refers to how much bleach they have to apply to the pulp later on to make it even whiter. So when we look here at the data set, I'll just show it to you quick. So there's our kappa number, our Y variable, and then below that, or next to that rather, we've got the chip feed rate into the reactor. Then we've got various other X variables that are measured around the reactor. You'll see a few of the variables end with numbers. So chip level 4, that shows actually that variable has already been lagged for you by 4 time steps. So this column has been shifted by 4 time units up because that chip level is referring to, over here, the height of the chip level. It has an effect on the kappa number, but the chip level that you see now doesn't affect the kappa number coming out here right now. It takes 4 hours before whatever the chip level was to affect what that kappa number is coming out, just given the slow pace at which the chips move through this digester. Similarly, the upper temperature has a delay of 2 hours. Okay, so this variable might be measured somewhere over here, T upper EXT2. The engineers have already determined this variable has a 2-hour delay in affecting kappa number. And T lower EX2 UCZAA. White flow is the flow rate of the white liquor, this fresh liquor coming in. It has a 4-hour delay as well before affecting kappa. So most of the X's have been pre-lagged for you. What I've done is I've unlagged chip rate and UCZAA. So I've put those two variables back to if we're recording the data right now at 4 o'clock on the process, UCZAA and chip rate are the values we record right now. But their effect on kappa is going to be delayed. So one of the questions I've asked you in the exercise is to find out how many hours, we take a new sample every hour, how many hours should chip rate have been lagged by to have the strongest response to Y? And you could guess what that is based on the diagram here. But UCZAA is the upper Cook zone alkali acid level, UCZAA. So it's some number that's up in the column over here. You need to also find out how many lags of UCZAA and chip rate are associated with Y. So you would add, like we showed there, you'd add many lags and then look at your loading plot and investigate that. So I would recommend, I'm not going to work through this exercise with you. I'm going to let you do it, and then I'll walk around and come help you out when you have questions. So you don't need to start with the first question. Jump straight ahead. What I will show you is how to add lags though. You don't need to do question one nor question two, but I will show you how to add lags. What you do is, in the software, go to find a new project, import data, and let me digest it. Import the Excel file, don't import the CSV file. Then set that as your primary. Then under, so we want to add lags of the chip rate variable, right? So you go to the lags column, select chip rate, and you don't know how many lags to add, so how many would you add? So you want to add lag 1, lag 2, lag 3, 4, 5, let's go up to 6 lags. We're just not sure how many to add, right? So just like 1, 2, 6 over here. And then click the arrow key, and it will add 6 lags for you. So you can write 1-6, or you can write 1, 2, 4, 6, if you just want to lag 1, 2, 4, and 6. Or you can just do all of them in one go, using 1-6. And then when you say OK, those are added automatically to the X space, and you build your model as normal. So the question here is, jump to question 3, which just says build an ordinary PLS model between the 21x variables and the CAFA number. And then you investigate the loadings plot as you normally would. But then question 4 says, go and add lags for UCZAA and chip rates, and then rebuild that PLS model and see how many lags are important. So start with question 3 and then move on to question 4. And then question 5 is you'll add a lag of kappa actually into the X space. So you add a Y variable back into your X space, lag.